How many of you know there is hope for this nation? We have hope. And I'm just so excited to see the next generation up on stage. And if you're here for the first time, we are a ministry that believes in the next generation. We invest highly. In fact, we share the stage with the next generation. They are not the leaders of tomorrow. They are the leaders of today. Somebody say amen. And I'll share the stage in a bit also with one of our student leaders, Jed, and he will teach with me and preach with me today in a moment. And we will be in 2 Chronicles chapter 34. So if you need to look for that in your Bibles or on your gadgets, we'll be there in a minute. Now, today, since it's campus weekend, we really have one message. It's not even a series because it's just a standalone message. And we're entitling it Game Changer. Game Changer. Changing the world has no age limit. And that's our subtitle for this one. And so I do want to define this term for us. A game changer is a newly introduced element or factor that changes an existing situation in a significant way. And so we look at history. There have been innovations and inventions and things that have been discovered that were game changers. And let me cite a few examples, one of which was the wheel, right? And in those days, or in the olden times, they would, you know, travel via horses and camels and donkeys. But when this was discovered, it really just revolutionized the way we would travel. And then, the printing press. When Gutenberg discovered and invented the printing press, it revolutionized all the books and the printing thereafter. And then, of course, also the telephone, Alexander Graham Bell. And many of you use, you know, the telephone and it's different kind of mode right now, these days. But that was so revolutionary, it allowed communication faster, swifter, and the connectivity from different locations all around the world. And then, of course, the invention of the light bulb. Then people were, you know, using lamps and candles. But when Thomas Edison discovered the light bulb, that was a game changer. And now in the recent times, the internet. How many of you know that's a revolutionary, it's a major game changer. In fact, I was reading a book, and in that book, it mentioned Dr. James Flynn talking about the Flynn effect. All right, what was it? What did it mean? Dr. James Flynn was talking about the research he did. He's from a University of Otago in New Zealand, and he was explaining about, you know, that the previous generations, all right, the generations after them were smarter than the previous generation, and the generation now is way smarter than the IQ. If you check the IQ of the generation now, it's higher than the previous generation. So how many of you know, parents, your kids are smarter than you today? Everything, you know, everything's Googleable now, okay? Because of the internet, you're able to search information and access education in a click. Now, in the recent times also, you know, in mobile communications, this was 2007, when Steve Jobs, during Macworld, stood up and said, I have a phone, an iPod, and an internet communicator, all rolled into one. We're calling it the iPhone. And that, too, revolutionized mobile communications. And so these were game changers. And there's a lot more out there that you could cite as examples. Now, as we get into the Word today, we're going to talk about a young man, very young, and yet the Lord used to change the complexion and the environment where he was in. This was the man, this boy's name was Josiah. Josiah was just 8 years old. He became king of Israel at 8 years old. And then at 16, he began to seek God. And somehow the Lord stirred something in his heart. And he started to seek after God at a very young age. And then at 26 years old, they discovered the book of the law. And when he read it, the Bible says he tore his clothes and he was repentant. And he was just convicted by the word. In fact, he read it aloud in front of everybody else. And so today I want to talk about three indicators and things that we can pull out of the life of Josiah, the things that he did that made him a world changer, a game changer. He had a desire, decision, and a devotion, an unquenchable desire, uncompromising decision, and an unwavering devotion. And to share in the first two points of the message today, I'm going to ask one of our student leaders, as I said, he just graduated last month from De La Salle University with a degree in engineering. So I want to ask Jed Sasse to come up and just share his thoughts on the first two points today. Let's give Jed a big, big round of applause as he comes.
Thank you, Pastor Paolo. Good afternoon, everyone. Hi. And as Pastor Paolo said, I'm Jed. I'm one of the leaders in Every Nation Campus. Every Nation Campus is one of our organizations in Victory where we reach out to students in the campuses. So today, I'm going to talk about unquenchable desire and uncompromising decision. Just to give a brief background about myself, I love math. In fact, I love calculating a lot. I love analyzing. In my high school days, I would on my lunchtime, before my quiz, I would get a large physics book, study pages of it, and you know, people call me a nerd. I'm still a nerd now, but a cool nerd. So I would study these and create equations that could quicken my answering on the quiz. Instead of studying for the quiz, I'm trying to make it faster. You know, I'm competing like my time, like how if it takes me 30 minutes, I'm gonna make it 10 minutes. So something like that. I love math. That's why I entered engineering. I built about 20 plus robots in my 5-year course, and I love Batman. So sudden shift from academics to entertainment. But I love Batman. I love how someone who has no powers can be a superhero. So really amazing. I love Chinese food. So if you want to eat out, let's go Chinese. And I love the next generation. I love how passionate and zealous they are for whatever they're passionate about. And that's why we want to reach out to these guys. These people are very passionate. And they're our next generation leaders. They're our future leaders. They're going to be in your position right now. Or even more. That's why I love the next generation. So we're going to look at 2 Chronicles 34, and we're going to talk about the next generation itself. Josiah, he was an 8-year-old boy when he began to reign, and he reigned 31 years in Jerusalem. Think of it this way. You've got this guy from kids' church, an 8-year-old guy, okay, an 8-year-old kid, and you pull him to Duterte's chair, President Duterte's chair, or our president, in the Philippines, and you let him sit there and let him handle all the responsibilities that President Duterte is doing, such as the Scarborough Shoal or the drug wars or the cleaning the government. We've got all these things, these great responsibilities on this kid, the next generation. How will it turn out? Are we thinking that, is this guy going to really be a great king? Can this guy rule our nation? We have to give significant responsibility to our next generation. Who knows that this guy might be a great king? Who knows that this guy is going to be a great CEO, making good business, excelling in every way, and honoring God with it? Or maybe he would be the next pastor or the next manager. Who knows? But he's going to be great. Let's give significant responsibility to our next generation. Look at this. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord and walked in the ways of David, his father. David was a great king, one of the best kings in Israel. And he did not turn aside to the right hand or to the left. He did what was right. In spite of bad examples, which his grandfather Manasseh, a king also of Israel, who sacrificed children for idols, who rebelled against God, who did evil in the eyes of the Lord, and who killed innocent people, shed blood of innocent people. That's how wicked his grandfather was. And there was Amon, his father, who did the same thing as what Manasseh has been doing. And worse, he would sacrifice his own children. That's how wicked these kings are. His grandfather and father were bad examples of ruling a nation. Injustice happening. And yet we see this Josiah, the next generation, doing right in the eyes of the Lord. He was doing right. How? Verse 3. For in the 8th year of his reign, 16 years old, while he was yet a boy, he began to seek the God of David, his father. What was he doing at 16 years old? He was beginning to seek God. There are moments wherein we feel like we go to church because we want to seek God. And that's good. That's great. I do that. I go to the service to know God more. And that it causes a desire. Because we know God a little, and he's a perfect God. He's a pleasing God. He's good. And I want to know more. I want to seek you, God, more. How many of you can relate to this? Or we attend a small group. We're in, okay, I'm going to try this out. This is the first time I'm attending small group. Why? Because I want to seek God more. Continue that. Because the more you know about God, the more you'll desire him. Desire. You see, it's like chocolates. Okay, yeah, chocolates out of nowhere, desire. Chocolates are actually, we have our own favorite chocolates. Mine is Hershey's. I love that it melts in my mouth, it's sweet. And you know, I know that this brand makes good chocolates. Some of you like Patchy, some of you like Toblerone, Cadbury, Kit Kat, I don't know. But all of us have our own favorite thing. And why do we desire it? Because we know it. We know the brand, we know the taste, we know that this one's my favorite. This one fits me. How about vegetables? I'm making you guys hungry. Yeah, it's lunchtime. But vegetables, we don't necessarily desire it. But once we come to know the vitamins it provides in our body, how it strengthens us for the day, we come to like it. We come to desire it. We come to seek that food because it makes us healthy. Same thing goes with our God. The moment we know the texture, the moment we know who he is, how great he is, you know, you attending church, that's not a waste of time. You're knowing God more. You're investing in this moment where it's going to change your life forever, knowing God. And it becomes a desire. I want to know you, God, more. I want to know you, God, more. We desire to see God because we know and eventually love him. This is Adrian Sailon. He's from Enderon Colleges, one of the people we minister here in Every Nation Campus. He lived in the province back then, practiced witchcraft there. That's where he learned witchcraft, did demonic things. And he had all these bad things that he's been doing. And he went to Manila to study in Enderon. He was out of supervision from his parents, so he said, I'll take this advantage and get drunk all day and all night. That's what he told me during that moment when I was asking him how did you get saved? And he said, you know what, I was a drunkard. Every day, every night, I drink. There was a time in school, I would go at the morning drunk. There was also a time that I was going back to my dormitory, my room, and I went to the wrong room because I was so drunk. I went to the wrong room, and he slept there, and then the owner said, hey, wake up, this is not your room. And he said, no, get out, this is my room. And so that's how drunk he was. And he said, no, leave me alone. And the owner said, I'll sue you. And he said, sue me all you want because this is my room anyway. That's how drunk he was. And that's how sinful he was. But later on, problems started to arise. Family issues started to arise in his life. School problems started to arise. And then his house started to get haunted because of all the witchcraft that he's been doing. And then he started to say, I don't want this life anymore. I want to know God more. God is merciful. God is loving. God is peaceful. I want to have that. Because of coming to know that. By the way, God allowed those problems in his life so that he could warn him that all these actions that you're doing, all the things that you're desiring now, will kill you later on. It will steal, it will kill, it will destroy you. You gotta have the right desire, which is me. I can give you life. I can provide for you. I can build you up and have a successful and purposeful life. This is Richard Medina, a campus missionary from Every Nation Campus. He reached out to Adrian, a student who had all these bad stuff in his background, and yet this guy reached out to him, did one-to-one with him. One-to-one is basically a seven-chapter booklet where we talk about the foundations of faith, of our faith. And that's what Richard Medina did. He did one-to-one with him. He went through Victory Weekend with him. And eventually, Adrian Sailon got saved. Not only did he get saved, he's doing more one-to-one with his classmates and his schoolmates. Right now, today, he's the president of our campus ministry in Enderon. He's doing that. You know why? Because God allowed that desire to come in his life and say, I'm going to build you up. You're not anymore going to be a drunkard. You're not anymore going to be a witchcraft person. But I'm going to build you up and make you better. Hello? Are we desiring God in a way that I know him? I love this God. God sought Adrian. God sought Lowell. God sought Aaron. God sought Jed. God sought you, each and every one of us. God sought us. That's why we can desire. We can desire to seek God because he sought us first. He desired us. He knew us. He knows what we've done, our flaws, our mistakes, and yet he says, I desire you anyway. And that's why we can desire a loving God who doesn't look at our mistakes, but rather looks, I can make this man perfect. I value this person. Desire. Let's desire to seek God. 2 Chronicles 34, verse 4. And they chopped down the altar. This is Josiah and his army. And they chopped down the altars of the Baals in his presence. And he cut down the incense altars that stood above them. And he broke in pieces the Asherim and the carved and the metal images. And he made dust of them and scattered it over the graves of those who had sacrificed to them. Skipping to verse 7, he broke down the altars and beat the Asherim and the images into powder and cut down all the incense altars throughout all the land of Israel. Then he returned to Jerusalem. What was he doing? He was taking out all that was a rebellion against God. He was doing what was insane to society during that moment. Society believed in these idols. Society believed that, you know, we got to rebel against God. We got to do this thing. It might be in our workplace. I've had my internship for 1 year and I've seen society how it is. There are moments where you get an opportunity to steal a certain product or even the pens or lie and gossip about people. Or maybe in school, we get the opportunity to cheat and to say, well, what's your answer? Say, why are you not sharing the answers? Society believes in those things. In this generation, we've got a lot of things to fix. Are we deciding on what's right? You know what's the difference of Josiah and the society? He had an uncompromising decision. He had the right desire, stood on his ground, and I'm not going to waver. I'm not going to shake with what the world thinks. Many people would think I'm weird, but I'm going to just break those idols. I'm just going to break it anyway. I'm just going to follow God anyway. I'm just going to worship God anyway. I'm going to worship God and honor him no matter what they say. Because I know he loves me and cares for me no matter how dirty I am. It's a decision. This is what we do in our campus ministry. We bond after the youth service. This is Friday, 6 p.m. And after the 6 p.m. youth service, we have dinner. We encourage one another. We play, have fun, and really talk about lives, shared lives. And these are two people, Aaron, you've seen him earlier in the tithes and offering. And this is AA, Eliza, from Enderon as well. These guys were in a class that time, and the professor wanted to test society, wanted to test how the next generation think. And so he said, okay, I'm going to talk about premarital sex, he said. And then he goes on further, Who here agrees that premarital sex should be done, that it's okay? Majority, 20 plus students, raised their hand. Then he said, who here is against premarital sex? Three of them, two of these guys, Elisa and Aaron, raised their hand, and one student who was not sure about her answer. And let me tell you, these guys are our next generation leaders. These guys are the next people who will manage companies, who will be parents one day. The next generation. In that class, majority voted something against, something. Can you see that? What they'll teach their children and their children's children and their children's children, children's children. Can you see that? Aaron and Elisa told the reason why they said no. Because the professor asked him, why? Why are you saying no to premarital sex? And Elisa here stood up and boldly preached the gospel to her classmates and to the professor. You know why? It's because Jesus loves me, and he told me that it's wrong. It's not gonna help me. It's gonna destroy me. Jesus lived the life that I should have lived and died the death that I should have died in my place. That's what she did. She boldly decided to preach the gospel. These are our students. These are the people that we're reaching out to in every nation campus. That's what we're doing. This is Tony Anthony Nicolas. He's in Ridley International School. We've gone through Victory Weekend. We did one-to-one. And this guy holds a worship night in Ridley International School. Started campus ministry there. He's the campus minister. Our student in Ridley, he's the one who's discipling the students there with his team. That's what they're doing. That's how the next generation looks like. When we disciple them right. When we decide that it's not about us. It's about God. It's about God imparting to the next generation. God cares for the next generation. He decided, I'm going to bless the descendants of Abraham. I'm going to bless the next generation. I'm going to bless the people coming after your children. I'm going to bless them. That's who God is. And he prioritized the next generation. He decided on investing on them. Verse 18, then Shaphan, the secretary, told the king, Hilkiah, the priest, has given me a book. This is the book of the law, which God has wrote ages ago during Moses' time. And this is the first time ever that Israel is going to see it again. Because they had a generation after generation of idolatry, of evil, of doing wicked things. Now they found the book of the law. And so Shaphan read it from it before the king. And when the king heard it, Josiah, the next generation heard it, he tore his clothes. And the king commanded Hilkiah, Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, Abdon, the son of Micah, Shaphan, the secretary, and Isaiah, the king's servant, saying, go inquire of the Lord for me and for those who are left in Israel and in Judah concerning the words of the book that has been found. For great is the wrath of the Lord that is poured out on us. We have done something great, greatly unsatisfying, because our fathers have not kept the word of the Lord to do all that is written in this book. You see, Josiah never heard the book of the law until now. But he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. He broke those idols. Why? Because he had some good examples too. Maybe it's his mother. Maybe it's Hilkiah the priest. I don't know. But someone imparted to them. Someone invested on them. Decided, I'm not gonna look at what society thinks of us, but I'm gonna invest in the next generation because God cares for the next generation. I'm gonna bless these people, and those are the ones that influenced Josiah into making the right decisions. Those are the people that imparted on Josiah, that's wrong, this is right, this is what God wants. These are my leaders, Pastor Patrick Mercado, who did one-to-one with me. He went to Victory Fort in the youth service. I was a student back then, and he came up to me. I thought he was a student too because he looked so young back then. And I told him, Patrick, kamusta? How are you? I treated him very close. I was like, I was just treating him like a student as well. Oh, how's school? And he was like, I'm not studying right now. I said, okay, that's weird. But later on, 2 weeks later, I find out he's going up on stage, started to speak, and he said, I want to, Pastor Rich was the pastor before in our youth service. And he said, I want to introduce our pastor, Pastor Patrick Mercado. And I was like, he's a pastor. So he comes up and speaks and then goes back down. And then he comes up to me and says, you want to do one-to-one with me? And I said, yes, I want to do one-to-one with you. And he does one-to-one with me. Goes through Victory Weekend. I went through Victory Weekend with him. And I already started to learn how discipleship is. How believing in the next generation is so effective. Because these are our next leaders. These are the people. These are lives we're dealing with. Relationship we're dealing with. This is Pastor James Macariola. If you know him, he's the one who does tithes and offering and transition here. And he's in Pioneer now. And this guy invested on me. Treated me food and really built relationships with me. We would have every Sunday, we would hang out. We would just chill and talk anything under the sun. We would talk about Ifugaos, we would talk about science and the planets. It's not necessarily related to moral laws, but this guy invested relationship with me. He started asking, oh, how's your love life? What are you doing right now? How's your studies? How's your friend right there? And he built relationship with me. He invested. He decided, I'm going to invest on the next generation. I'm believing in this kid. And we have Pastor Joseph Bonifacio. He mentored me in wisdom and in truth. He spoke life and really taught me how to read a lot of books. He loves reading. If you know him, he doesn't read books. He devours them. And he teaches me those. And we have this small group. We have Marco Abelio here. We learn from him. Why? He believes in the next generation. I'm sure these guys have their own lives. I'm sure they have, they can do anything else besides investing on the next generation. But why do they do that? Because of the desire to seek God and His righteousness. Desire to seek God and advance His kingdom. And through campus ministry, through the next generation. Because it's not only that these are lives, it's also something that God wants. I want this. I want to bless generations after generations after. I want to bless humanity itself. There are moments wherein it's hard for us. Are we really going to invest? I'm going to miss my show. Spider-Man's going to come up in 15 minutes and... Are we investing on them? Are we imparting? This guy is annoying. This kid is annoying. He's so arrogant. With all the Google information that he has. Let's take the time to teach this kid, to discipline this kid. I'm glad that my dad does that to me. He gives me significant responsibility and disciplines me on how to do it. And you can too. We can too. We can invest in the next generation, impart to them, even if it's difficult. Because God will empower us to do so. God will empower us in every good work. He has promised that. For every good work, I will equip you. That's what He says. He's going to equip you. Let's stop complaining about the next generation and let's start investing on them, building them up. 10 times better than us. Let us do that. And then for the next generation, let's submit to them. Let's listen to them. There are moments it's going to be difficult, but this is right. I got to listen. This is right. I got to listen. I got to do it. My desire is there, but the decision is quite difficult. Start doing it. Slowly. It's going to come. It's going to become a reality for you and I. Amen? Okay, Pastor Paolo.
Thank you. Thanks, Jed. Great. Awesome. How many of you, there's hope for the future? Amen. Praise God. Now, let me try to end this. We talked about a desire that Josiah had. Number two, we talked about the decision that he made. And then finally, an unwavering devotion. Where did we see that? The Bible says in verse 31, the king stood in his place and made a covenant before the Lord to walk after the Lord and keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all his heart. Everybody say, all his heart. With all his heart and all his soul to perform the words of the covenant that were written in this book. It was a personal decision. He made a decision. I'm going to do this. I heard the word of God, and it so captivated his heart. It so arrested his heart. I need to do something about this. How many of you know the word of God is powerful? And once it is preached, it will accomplish the purpose for which it was sent. And that's why I want to encourage you to keep reading the word. Keep hiding it in your heart. The Bible says, I've hidden your word in my heart so that I might not sin against you. And so keep memorizing that and reading it. Now, verse 32, the Bible says, then he made all that were present in Jerusalem and in Benjamin to join it. And the inhabitants of Jerusalem and did according to the covenant of God, the God of their forefathers. And then verse 33, Josiah took away all the abominations from all the territory that belonged to the people of Israel and made all who were present in Israel serve the Lord their God. And then after that, all his days, I want to highlight that, all his days, they did not turn away from following the Lord, the God of their fathers. That's devotion. It's not just a one-time decision. All your days, you follow the word of God, all his days. Now, that doesn't mean perfection, but what it means is allegiance. That, Lord, whatever happens, you're my Lord. Whatever happens, you're my boss. Whatever happens, you are the one who I will say yes, sir, to. Amen? Now, I remember I mentioned to you a few weeks ago about the bike trip my son and I had. He wanted, you know, for his 13th birthday, he wanted to bike from Tokyo to Mount Fuji. Okay, and so, you know, one of the things that we did, you know, as I told you, you know, that we had a phone and it was the Google Maps that was giving us direction, turn left, turn right. And whenever we would need to turn left or right, I would shout to him, say, hey, you know, Ryan, turn left, or Ryan, turn right, or go keep going straight. But, you know, the reason why he would do as I would instruct him to do it is because of the trust that he had in me. Because of the relationship we have. And the instruction, I would say, either left or right or go straight, was based on that relationship. And you see, you and I today, we have a Heavenly Father. And what He says, we do, not because we have to. We do what He says because of that relationship we have with Him and His relationship He has with us. That He says, you know, that I know the plans I have for you. Plans for future, not for calamity or harm, but for your hope and a future for you. And because of that plan, we latch onto it and say, okay, my Father, I trust Him. My God, I'll follow Him. And His instructions are always best for me. Some of you need to hear that today. Because God gives you a plan, God gives you an instruction, and you doubt. But you know, the Bible says that His intentions are always good for you. If He gave His Son for you, on your behalf, how much more will He give all things for you? Now, as we end our time today, do we trust Him? Can we trust Him with the way Josiah did? Lord, I trust You and I will fully give my life into Your hands, devotion all the days of my life. And the question is, why not? Why not put your life into the hands of somebody who sacrificed, who gave, who unconditionally and unendingly loves you? The Bible says in 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, 1 verse 19 rather, 4 verse 19, we love because He first loved us. The reason why we're able to love Him and have devotion and seek Him is because He did that for us first. Romans 5, 8, God demonstrated His love for us while we're still sinners. Jesus died for us. Amen. Can we bow our heads and pray as we end our time here today? Lord, thank You for, Lord, our time here as a congregation. We're grateful, Lord God, for men like Jed and like Aaron, Lord, who you are raising up as the next generation of leaders for this nation. And thank you, Lord God, that you're going to multiply what the work you're doing in the campuses. Lord, we're going to see a generation of young people who will be on fire for you, who will stand upon your word and will not compromise. There's going to be a desire for you. There's going to be a decision to do your word, and there's going to be devotion to continuously seek after your will. And so today, Lord God, we just lift you up the next generation. You know what we're going to do today as we pray? I'm going to ask Aaron to come up, and I'm going to ask Aaron to pray for the next generation. I'm going to ask you, if you're here today, if you're a student, high school, university, or even elementary, or master's, okay? If you are a student today, could you stand up? I want to pray for you. Just go ahead and stand up, okay? I want to take a moment to pray. And I'm going to ask Aaron to pray in a bit, all right? Those of you in the balcony down here, stand up. Look at me for a moment. Look up here. I need you to know that God loves you. That's the first thing you need to know. That He unconditionally is crazy and madly in love with you. He's so crazy He gave His Son to die on the cross for you. And your identity, okay, is not hinged on what people say. Who you are today is not hinged on what society will try to push you into the mold that the society's telling you. You are who you are today because you're a child of God. Jesus loves you and has a wonderful plan for you. There's greatness inside your DNA. I'm not trying to say that to make you feel good. I'm saying that because that's the truth. That's what the Bible says. You need to embrace that. Don't fling your life into something that is temporary. Throw your life into something that is long-term, something that will last forever. Okay? And so I want to take a moment and ask Aaron to pray for us, to pray for you as you are the next generation. Aaron, can you pray?
Is it okay, guys, if we could stretch out our hands to the next generation? Dear God, thank God for this time that we're all together here. We're praying for the next generation, Father. Just pray, oh God, that all the more we meet more of you, oh God. Just pray that all these leaders here, all these young people over here, just has a greater encounter with you, oh God.
Yes, yes.
That they know more of you. If you have put this in us, this love that you have, the reason why that there is so much passion within me is because there's so much love within me, oh God, that came from you. I just pray that you also send this to them, that they also encounter this love that you have for all of us. Pray for more encounter of you. A meeting with you, O God, a sensitivity that's so much greater, so much deeper with you, O God, that when we hear your word, when we read your word, you're clearly saying something to us. Pray, Father, that not only that they encounter you, God, but they be used to preach the gospel, to preach the gospel to whoever you bring them to. Use them, God, to preach the gospel because it overflows in them. The love just overflows in them, oh God. I pray that they understand that you have a great purpose.
Yes.
You have a great purpose for each and every single one of us here. That there's so much greater in you, God, rather than the things that we think here. You have a greater plan, Father. Just declare, Father, in Jesus' name, that this plan and your will for all these men and all these women come from you. This we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 Thanks, Aaron. You may take your seats. I want to take a moment also to pray for the parents. You have a very important role in the lives of the next generation. In fact, you have a small group right there in your home. You do. What you do with your life, the example that you show, will spell a huge difference in the lives of the young people, the next generation today. So if you're a parent today, can I ask you to stand up? I want to take a moment to pray for you. If you're a parent here, I know there's a lot, but I need you to, if I could just take a moment to pray for you. Lord, I just pray for every single parent here. Stretch out your hands towards a parent here, if you're sitting beside them. Lord, I pray for every parent here today. Thank you, God, that the Bible says, Lord God, that you give us wisdom. If we lack wisdom, you'll give it to us generously without finding fault. Lord, I pray for every mom and dad. Lord, I know we're trying to juggle a lot of balls, Lord, from work to house to, Lord, other things that we're trying to cover. But Lord, I thank you that, Lord, your grace is more than sufficient for every single one of us. That, Lord God, you are with us and not against us. You are for us and not against us. Lord, I pray for, Lord, your leadership and your direction. That we would know that we have precious ones. Those that are, whether they're little or they're already adults, they are, Lord, our next disciples, are the next leaders of this nation. And so, Lord, thank you that you're going to give us wisdom how to train them in the way they should go, so that when they grow old, they shall not depart from what they have learned. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Can we all stand? Let's all stand. I'm going to ask Coach Joey. Coach Joey, to come up here. You know, one last thing we want to pray for. We have campus missionaries that reach out to 10 campuses now in Fort Bonifacio, BGC, Taguig area. There's 45 campuses around our area. Within a, 10-mile radius or 10-kilometer radius, there's about 45 high school and university campuses. And obviously, this number is not enough to try to reach out to all of these. And so we're trying to ask, and you know, for this service, it's Joey and Pastor Joseph that are our campus missionaries. But you know, like what I said, there's a lot more of them, but we need a lot more. There's 10 that we're reaching out to. There's 45 more that we haven't reached out, and we don't have a campus missionary. So I want to ask Coach Joey to pray. You know, those include, you know, ISM, British School Manila, Our Papa High School, University of Makati, Taguig, TUP, Taguig, PUP, Taguig. Okay, some of those are the campuses that we're reaching out to. So I want to ask Coach Joey to pray for future campus missionaries, for our campus missionaries now, and for the campuses that we're trying to reach out.
Heavenly Father, we just praise you and we honor you. We thank you, God, and Lord, that the campuses are yours, God. We pray for all the campuses here in BGC area within the 10-kilometer radius, God. We pray, God, by faith, we claim that there will be open doors, God. We pray for influence, God. We pray for favor from the administration, even to the owners of the schools, God, that indeed nothing is impossible with you, God, that slowly, Lord, you will turn their hearts of stone to hearts of flesh and see hope in the students, Lord, that all in all, Lord, we are in the same team, Lord, that we believe in the young people. So, Father, we declare, God, for doors to be opened, God. For administrators to see, Lord, that there will come to the saving knowledge of you, from the teachers, to the staff, to the admin, even to the janitors in that place, God. Lord, yes, we declare, God, that these people who come to the saving knowledge of you will be discipled as well, God. That they will be connected to the church. That they will be discipled for your greater glory, God. And I pray for all the students, God. Those, Lord, that we're connecting to them, Lord, through our groups, through our campus ministries, God, that they will come to their events more than enjoying, more than the company of people, but just believing and feeling in their hearts that they need Jesus. Heavenly Father, we praise you and we honor you, God. Give us wisdom. Give us guidance, God, to have mentors, to bring more leaders, victory group leaders, that more students will rise up, God, to mentor and disciple the next leaders in the yes, campuses, God. Yes. Lord, anything is possible, God. We just pray for breakthrough. For this is the year of breakthrough for BGC, God. And more men and women, more, even parents, even grandparents, even students, even faculty, Lord, you will touch their hearts, God, telling them, Lord, how they can help the young generation, whether through prayer, whether through sharing their talents, whether through giving time and giving impartation, just like what happened to Adrian, to Jed, and even to Aaron, God, to all the students, God, because we believe in the next generation, God. And we pray most of all, God, for all the students, for all the young professionals, God. We know, God, you've planted the seed in their hearts, that you have called them to go full-time, that you have called them to serve the students in a full-time capacity, God. I pray for boldness. I pray for them to step out in faith, God. Lord, that you have called each one. And I pray for everyone here in this place, God, that we will continue to worship you, we will continue to honor you and partner with the next generation, Lord, for your greater glory. Lord, we give you honor and praise. Thank you for the privilege to serve you and to honor you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. 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 Amen.